show's about to begin, so you need to get up.
Get motivated.
Hip-hop motivated, blowing wisdom on the mic with Sean.
What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome to another live broadcast of Flow of Wisdom. I am your host, Sean Anthony. My website is flowofwisdom.com. I'm excited to introduce my next guest. Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein is an assistant professor of physics and astronomy, also a core faculty member in women's studies at the University of New Hampshire. She's also a columnist for New Scientist. I want to welcome, for the first time to Flow of Wisdom, Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein. Hello, Dr. Chanda. Welcome to Flow of Wisdom. How are you?
I'm doing all right. How about you?
I'm doing great. First of all, I'm very excited to speak with you. Let me just give you a little quick rabbit trail in context and how I found you. Obviously, it was around last year. Obviously, you're probably not familiar with my show, Flow of Wisdom, but we talk about technology. We talk about quantum physics. We talk about artificial intelligence, social engineering, as it pertains to not only the technology, but social media and mainstream media as well. But I was going through some research looking at some of the particle accelerators, because I've done shows focusing on CERN, the Large Hadron Collider. And one of my listeners, I think, may have mentioned in times past about the Fermilab, the particle accelerator that's here in the United States. And perusing through the website, I was looking for contacts who I can reach out to and get them on my show. And I'm like, okay, this person, Then I seen somebody with some melanin and I got excited. And then on top of that, a female. And then after I did more research on you, I was really impressed. But that's how I found you, was through Fermilab. So can we just kind of start there? And of course, we'll take different routes about, you know, your journey and into led you to where you are right now. But what led you to the Fermilab with the particle accelerator there?
Yeah, so I actually spent a summer working for a professor at the University of Chicago named Henry Frisch. It was the summer after my first year of college, so this was in the summer of 2000. It's been a while now, 20 years ago almost.
Wow.
And at the time, Henry was a member of the Collider Detector at Fermilab collaboration. So there's the particle collider at Fermilab that's actually basically no longer operational. Pretty much everybody's moved on to the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland and France. But at the time, there was this one loop, and then there were different experiments that had built like different types of detectors to do different types of particle detections on it. So the one that Henry was a member of was the Collider Detector at Fermilab, known as CDF. And so I applied for a summer research experience program at the University of Chicago because I wanted to actually start trying to do some real physics instead of just what I was finding to be relatively boring stuff in the classroom. Mm-hmm. And I got assigned to Henry's lab, and so I spent the summer building a part for the CDF. And this part, it was an electronics board that converted analog to digital signals and vice versa. And it was actually used in the experiment. So I designed it on a computer, but then they had them fabricated, and it was actually printed with the words Chanda's board on it.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, so that was kind of my one contribution. And as I went through the summer, and in kind of hindsight, as I've continued to have a relationship with Henry Frisch and his family, I think that one of the reasons I was placed with him is because his family had kind of a long history of being involved in the civil rights movement and also of supporting the training of black physicists. He's a white Jewish man. And so I think it wasn't like a total coincidence that I got placed with him in particular.
Hmm. Yeah, it wasn't by an accident. It was all on purpose, seemed like.
Yeah, no, I think that the people running the program, sometimes these things are like not the best decision, but I think they looked at my application, and Henry's father had been a mentor and advisor to multiple well-known black physicists. Jim Gates is an example. Shirley Ann Jackson's another example. Shirley Ann Jackson was the second black woman to ever earn a PhD in physics, and she was the first in theoretical physics. And in fact, Henry's father, David Frisch, was a professor at MIT, and he mentored the first black woman to earn a master's degree in physics in 1953. And that was Carolyn Parker. So the family really did kind of have this long tradition, and Henry is definitely an activist and sent his kids to public school, unlike a lot of University of Chicago faculty send their kids to private school. But he was very committed to, like, the community and grassroots. And so I think that that's one of the reasons I got placed with him.
It makes sense because you became the first black woman in history to hold a faculty position in theoretical cosmology. Is that correct?
Yes.
Now, also, you have 2 degrees in astrophysics and 2 degrees in astronomy. Is that correct? Is that accurate?
So my undergraduate degree I majored in 2 things. So I did a physics major and I did an astronomy and astrophysics major. So it's technically like the way that it works at Harvard is you only get like one degree. They don't do duals, but it was a double major. Hmm. Then I did a master's in astronomy and astrophysics, and then I did a PhD in physics. So technically I have 2 degrees in physics and 2 degrees in astronomy.
So from my understanding, you got inspired at an early age and you wrote a letter, or was it an email, to the late Stephen Hawking, and one of his team members replied back to you and told you step by step on how to become a physicist. Is that correct?
Yeah, I think I must have been 11 years old. I think that it was pretty early in, it was basically right as the World Wide Web became live. So I must have been 12.
Wow.
At that point. And I sent an email I found his email address on the Cambridge University website and sent an email and said, I want to be a theoretical physicist like you. What do I need to do in order to become a theoretical physicist? And one of his graduate students replied and explained that I needed to go to a good university, and then after I graduated from university, I needed to go get a PhD, and then once I had my PhD, I would become a professor. And it was obviously actually not that simple, but it was at that point that I realized that I had to figure out what are the schools that are a good place to study physics, and so I decided that I was going to go to Caltech or Harvard. I also looked at financial aid because I realized I needed to go to a school that would give good financial aid. And that was kind of what set me on the path.
Now, that's pretty impressive. You grew up on the West Coast, right? Like, what was it, like the Los Angeles or Watts area? I forgot where exactly you grew
up. Yeah, I'm from East Los Angeles, which, like Watts, is a working class, low-income community. Primarily, although I guess the part of East LA where I grew up, El Sereno, has gentrified a lot in the last 10 years. So you now have these houses that are going for like $1 million.
Just like every other black neighborhood in the U.S., right?
Right. No, and not just like, so actually the neighborhood where I grew up was primarily a Mexican-American, Central American community. But as with many communities of color and black, like even going back to like the Crenshaw area in Los Angeles, where I used to run for a track team called the Los Angeles Jets in the Crenshaw area. And that whole area is like totally unrecognizable to me at this point. Like it used to be like white people would tell you, don't go there. And now they're all like buying houses there, right? So,
yeah, that's a lot of neighborhoods across the U.S. So back to the physics, how much math does it take to achieve the academic heights that you've achieved? Like, even now that you're a professor, you're teaching, you're writing papers and stuff like that, how much math and what type of math is all involved with your research today?
So for the folks out there who have taken calculus, I would say that once you have learned calculus, you've basically really learned the foundation of what you will need to know mathematically to do theoretical physics. Like pretty much everything else in theoretical physics builds on calculus. It's not like 100% accurate, but it's pretty close. In particle physics, we also use a lot of what we call algebra. it's pretty different from the algebra that people learn in like middle school and high school and college. Mm-hmm. Or like, you know, if you're doing like an introduction to algebra class, it's pretty different from like what math majors do, for example. And that happens to be because the best way to describe the equations in particle physics is using these techniques that come out of the area of mathematics that is formally known as algebra. Mm. But really, I would say once you know calculus, you are, you know, more than halfway there, because then you're just going to be learning fancy, different fancy versions of calculus, but they all rely on the same thing, derivatives and integrals, basically.
Okay. So I want to go back to, it's interesting you mentioned when I, the Fermilab, you said it's non-operational now. One, how long has it been out of operation as far as the particle accelerator? Because they're still operating the facilities there, but you're saying the particle accelerator at Fermilab is non-existent in Illinois, right?
Yeah, so it's true that they're not really using the particle accelerator to do active like particle collisions anymore, but it's an extremely active research facility. There's another black cosmologist who is employed at Fermilab named Brian Nord. And he and I are actually starting to do some research together, which is really exciting. So it's a very active research facility. A lot of the teams there are involved in particle experiments in other places. So a lot of them are involved in the experiments at the Large Hadron Collider in Europe. There are also people who are involved in various dark matter detection experiments that are scattered around the United States and also around Europe. So a lot of different connections. It's a very thriving research environment, from what I understand. Even though the collider is not really central to what Fermilab is at this point. And you know, they also still have all their buffalo. They have a herd of buffalo that live on the grounds there.
Wait a minute, what's in buffalo?
They have they have a herd of bison that live on the grounds at Fermilab.
Oh wow! Now,
yeah, so you can drive in and see, and you'll sometimes see them like grazing on the prairie.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we got to take a quick break as we are talking to Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein. Stay right there. We'll be back after this on Flow of Wisdom Radio. And welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony. My guest, Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein. The Fermilab, you said it's non-operational now. So why is it not operational anymore?
It's really that the energy levels needed to get to the next level of science that people wanted to explore couldn't be achieved in a facility of that size. And so the Large Hadron Collider is bigger.
And that's actually shutting down because they're actually expanding the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland now, right?
Yes. Yeah, so they are actually upgrading the facility. And I think it's going to be off for another 2 years. Mm-hmm. Don't hold me to that, though. I'm a theorist, and so you can ask me questions about experiment, but at some point I won't understand what I'm talking about because I'm a theorist.
You said you won't understand what you're talking about.
Yeah. Oh, man. Doing experimental physics is, like, really hard, and I'm glad to be a theoretical physicist instead.
I see. Have you ever visited the CERN Large Hadron Collider?
Yeah. So I actually visited it in, I guess, 2009. It's been a while. So actually, before they turned it on, I saw the ATLAS detector, there were two major experiments that were watching the particle collisions there. And one of them was ATLAS. And it's enormous. Like, we had to go multiple stories underground, and it was, you know, bigger than a mansion. Mm. And it's like an incredible feat of human engineering that people were able to plan it and then execute it and actually get it to work. And whenever people tell me that there are problems that we can't solve, I think this is a matter of will, because if we can build something like the ATLAS detector, we can certainly solve other technical problems that we face.
I agree with you 100%. I totally agree with that. What is the exactly the Atlas detector?
So the Atlas detector, basically, you have this this particle collider, the Large Hadron Collider. So there are literally particles that are being sent through the collider, and then maybe they're colliding with each other, so they're smashing into each other. And the reason that you would want to do that, so these are going very fast, like some significant fraction of the speed of light, for example. And the reason that you would want to smash them together is that when they break into pieces, you can see subatomic particles that maybe we haven't observed before.
Mm-hmm.
And so the most famous example in the case of the Large Hadron Collider is the Higgs boson. So the Higgs is the particle that causes all of the matter that we see around us. So, you know, whatever your recording studio equipment is made out of, my phone, all of that, it has mass. Which we experience in daily life as a weight because of the Higgs. So,
And they call it a God particle, right?
That's definitely something that one physicist called it. There are lots of physicists who I don't have an emotional reaction to this, but there are a lot of people who get real upset.
Really?
If you call it the God particle.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people in the physics community are not very religious folk, and so they try and keep that kind of language out of it.
Okay.
But the Higgs causes everything to have mass, and then the amount of mass in an object will determine how much what its weight is on, like, Earth or on the Moon and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So what the detectors are is that they're really where, if you think about it, like trying to take a picture of the collision, the detectors are basically like a camera in some sense, in that they're detecting where the particles go and what they do and what their energy levels are. And it's actually an incredible computing problem because there's so much information coming out of the detector that one of the big challenges was creating a computing pipeline that would take in all of the information and turn it into something useful without a human needing to look at every single piece of information.
So when these particles collide, and obviously you guys are, the physicists are studying the reaction, the repercussions from that. I've read in certain articles, and you can help me get clarity on this, but there are openings of parallel universes or wormholes or black holes. Was it creating those type of phenomena when these particles collide?
No, you're not going to get anything like that. Definitely, I think there were some people who were really worried that a black hole would be created in the Large Hadron Collider, and there was never any possibility that that was going to happen. So people shouldn't have been worried about it. But I should tell you that the reason they were worried is because if a black hole was created on Earth, that would be really bad news for us.
Yeah.
It would be quite destructive to the planet itself to have a black hole on the planet. So it's really good that the Large Hadron Collider can't create things like that. And there's no reason to think that anything involving parallel universes or wormholes or anything like that would come into existence in the Large Hadron Collider.
Stay right there, ladies and gentlemen. We've got to take another break with my guest, astrophysicist Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein. Don't go anywhere. I'm Sean Anthony, and this is Flow of Wisdom. Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom. I am Sean Anthony, 877-300-7645, or flowofwisdom.com. Flowofwisdom.com. You can connect with me there and send me a note, questions, comments, or feedback. I'm joined by special guest, astrophysicist, Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein. So is that more outside of our atmosphere, the wormholes and black holes? And is that more so out of space and not so much here on Earth?
Yeah, so black holes can form in a few different ways. And I should say that a lot of what we know about black holes is very theoretical, right? Because they absorb all light and they don't emit detectable light, it's very hard for us to actually just, like, go watch a black hole do its thing. Although we're getting better at detecting closer and closer to the edge of a black hole, what we call the event horizon.
Mm.
And we think that black holes are mostly formed from stars collapsing.
You say stars collapsing?
Yeah, so when a star gets to the end of its life, it will collapse. And if the star is big enough, it might collapse into a black hole.
Wow.
If it's massive enough, so it has to have a lot of mass. So our sun will not become a black hole at the end of its life. It's not massive enough. But something that's like maybe 10 times larger than our sun potentially could.
Wow. That's pretty fascinating. Now, break it down for us in layman's terms to my listeners out there. You said it would be devastating if a black hole were to happen on Earth. From my understanding, and you can chime in and finish up and clarify better than I can, but it absorbs everything, light and anything existing, right? It would just absorb it and pretty much suck it up. Is that fair to say, or what would happen if there was hypothetically a black hole here in Earth?
Yeah, so a black hole is going to consume everything in its path.
Hmm.
So I don't know if this is like a really, if this is the best analogy, and I'm definitely showing signs of my age, but for people who grew up with the never-ending story.
Oh, yeah, I grew up with that. Go ahead.
Yeah, okay. So for people who grew up with the never-ending story, apologies to like all of the young millennials slash like generation, like, I don't know, Y, Z, I can't keep track. The never-ending story is kind of the thing that keeps growing and consuming their world of imagination, right? Mm-hmm. So I would say like a black hole is very similar to that, except nobody's going to survive.
Mm.
But if you think about like, you know, there are those scenes in the film of the never-ending story where this wind comes in and everything gets like ripped away. That black holes in reality actually do something like that. So, if a black hole were placed near our sun, the sun wouldn't just like fall inside the black hole, but rather the black hole would start feeding off the sun. So the black hole would be so massive that it would attract particles from the sun, and you would basically get a stream of the sun going into the black hole. And we think most realistic black holes are rotating. So you would get a stream from the sun into this black hole, rotating around the black hole. So this forms what we call an accretion disk. And then it's like a spiral. So if you think about like the drain in a bathtub, like things are just kind of spiraling down the drain and eventually falling into the drain, but they kind of have to spiral around it for a little bit first. And that's what we would expect, something like that to happen if you placed, you know, a black hole near the sun. But if you were to put it inside the sun, then that whole process then starts to happen from the inside. And you basically would have structural instabilities, right?
Right. Talk about dark matter and how that relates to, our reality and science.
Yeah, so basically, dark matter is our name for a bunch of matter that we can't see. So it actually would have been better to call it clear matter or transparent matter, because it's not that it's dark. It's just that light goes right through it.
Mm.
And we think that most of the matter in the universe is actually in the form of dark matter and is not in the form of the everyday matter that we are made of. So I call it everyday matter, but actually we are made of what is basically abnormal matter. Most of the matter in the universe is actually the dark matter. So the dark matter is the normal stuff, and we are the abnormal stuff.
Wow, that's interesting. That's really interesting. Are you familiar with Michael Talbot, his book, The Holographic Universe?
Oh, wow. That's old school, isn't it?
Yeah. Okay. Tell me about it. I don't know. I read his book, though. Go ahead.
I haven't read it, but I feel like I haven't heard about that book in a while. Certainly, so the holographic universe Oh, man. I actually think I can't even say anything. I can't even necessarily say anything about that because I'm not sure that he means holographic in the way that it usually gets used in theoretical physics now.
Really?
So I think I can't say anything about that.
Well, I will. One of the things that stands out to me in his book where he talks about when you observe something, it's there. But when you're not observing, it doesn't move. It's not there. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So I'm not sure I can really say anything about this because holography is not one of my areas of expertise.
Okay. That's fine. I just thought I'd bring it up. It was one of the shows that I've covered before talking about that subject. But anyway, let's talk about time and space-time and time travel. What is your research showed you about space-time as well as time travel? Is time travel possible?
You know, there are people who think about how to make time travel work. I don't think it's ever going to happen, but there are definitely people who have tried to make it work. And I think that there are people who have worked out theoretical scenarios where it could happen, but the energy levels required are nonsensical in terms of things that are within the realm of human possibility.
Really? Why don't you think it? I mean, I guess you just explained it, but can you go a little deeper? Why do you think time travel is not possible? You say we don't have the capacity, the energy to do so?
Yeah, I can't give you numbers because it's not something that I thought about in a while. But I think that the energy that would be necessary would be so enormous that it's not something that would ever become feasible on Earth.
Even with the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland?
Yeah, I think that the Large Hadron Collider is like chump change in comparison.
Wow.
Yeah. The one thing that I try and be careful about, though, is that I say right now that it's like not really conceivable or realistic, but things change. And I think that actually one of my jobs as a theoretical physicist is to keep an open mind. So it's entirely possible that at some point, somebody will figure something out that will like radically change our understanding of what's possible and what's not possible.
What are your thoughts on space and time? Like understanding time, it's a really, when you start to really, at least for me, I'm speaking for myself, when I really start to ponder and think about time and it and how it applies here on Earth and how it's could be different in space. And then you look at the time zones and the way that the sun sets and the Earth axis and rotate. All of these things I started going through, you know, this funnel of thoughts. Can you help me understand space, time, and time relative time? Does that make sense? I hope I'm making sense. I'm trying to.
You know, I mean, I think space time. I get asked about space-time a lot. You're definitely not the only one who has that question.
Okay.
It is a little bit of a strange thing to think about because the way that we live our everyday lives, we think of space and time as very separate, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like when I drive my car, I can go forwards, I can go backwards, I can go sideways. I have a concept of like three dimensions and the only restriction on my movement in those dimensions is, like, my capacity to propel myself, right? So I can also, like, go upwards if I have a way of getting myself up there. But there's no physical barrier to moving in those directions. Time is very different. We experience it as a one-dimensional thing that always goes forward.
Hmm.
And so it's completely natural to be, like, I just like, you know, don't understand how space and time could be merged together. It turns out that if you want to properly account for the speed of light being constant, so in Einstein's special relativity, then space-time, you have to think about space-time as mixing. And so if I'm moving at a very high speed, and I mean, and by high speed, I don't mean like, you know, you have a nice Ferrari. I mean like you're going at some significant fraction of the speed of light. Then you and I are going to experience time differently because our space and time are going to mix differently.
That's really interesting stuff, man. I'm just over here just trying to soak it all in. Stay right there, ladies and gentlemen. We got to take another break as we are carrying on this fascinating discussion with my guest, astrophysicist Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein. Don't go anywhere. I'm Sean Anthony, and this is Flow of Wisdom. And welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony. Toll-free number is 877-300-7645. My guest, Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein. Can we switch to astronomy? Now, you have a degree in astronomy as well. Are you doing any research currently on astronomy? And if so, what is your focus on?
Yeah, so a couple of things. So one, dark matter is definitely an astronomical problem as well as a physics problem. And so my research on dark matter definitely falls into like astronomy and astrophysics. I'm also doing some work involving neutron stars. So these are basically, I don't know, to put it a little bit morbidly, neutron stars are like the carcasses of stars.
Okay.
So a star that has gone, a massive star, like that's maybe 8 times larger than the sun, goes supernova, and eventually what will be left behind is a very, very dense object that we call a neutron star.
A dense object? How would you describe it?
They're like the coolest thing in the universe.
Okay.
So neutron stars, like, if you think about, like, you know, putting, like, a spoon, if you think about putting all of the city of Los Angeles into a spoonful of sugar.
Okay.
That's how dense it is. Like, if you just squeeze Los Angeles into a spoonful.
Wow. And this comes from a star itself?
Yeah, so it starts with a star that's a little bit bigger than the sun. And basically, those stars are going to, when they start to run out of their nuclear fuel, so the thing that keeps a star stable is that they continuously have nuclear explosions that are pushing photons outward, pushing light outward, and creating, like, outward pressure. Mm-hmm. And eventually, they're going to run out of fuel for having these explosions and creating this outward pressure. And when they run out of fuel, the matter that is on the outside will suddenly fall onto the center of the star and basically bounce off of it. And so this is an example of a type of supernova that can occur. So, and it will blow everything off. This is like the most awesome explosion that happens in the universe. And after everything is thrown off, you get left with just the core, which is going to mostly be made of neutrons.
Mm. But these aren't tiny, small neutrons. These are massive neutrons, correct?
So the neutron stars are going to be made of like the same type of like tiny neutron that's in like atoms. But it's true that the star itself will kind of be like one giant neutron. It's not exactly like a giant neutron because it will also have some electrons in it. And so it's a little bit different from being a giant neutron. But it is a lot of neutrons packed together.
Wow. Interesting. So help clarify for me what you do with astrophysics, theoretical physics, and astronomy. You're not so much looking into the telescope. You're taking the research that they find from a telescope and drawing theoretical possibilities. Is that kind of what you do, or is it something
That's
different?
That's most of what I do. Like, there are really two ways to go about this, which is one, to take to try and solve problems that have been found in the data, and then also to try and make predictions about what the data will look like with a certain, if a certain theory is correct.
Hmm. Where do you get the images? Where do you get the information? Do you work with another physicist or astronomer or something like that and get their information, and then you study that? Or how does your process work in your research?
Yeah, it really depends. A lot of the problems that I have specifically tackled in my research involve longstanding open problems. So the problems are well known, they're well established, and I don't have to do anything special to get the data or to find out what the problems are, because it's a problem people have been trying to solve for a long time. In the case where, you know, I'm trying to make predictions about data, I am currently involved in some proposed telescopes that some proposed space telescopes, and those space telescopes, because I would be an active member of the team, I would have early access to the data for comparing with any models that I develop for them. So it really depends on kind of what particular thing that you're doing and whether you're trying to make predictions for data that doesn't exist yet or whether you're trying to explain data that's been around for a while.
All right, stay right there. We got to take another break as we are talking to astrophysicist Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein. Don't go anywhere. This is Flow of Wisdom Radio. Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom. I am Sean Anthony, 877-300-7645, or flowofwisdom.com. Flowofwisdom.com. You can connect with me there and send me a note, questions, comments, or feedback. I'm joined by special guest, astrophysicist Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein. So you mentioned that dark matter is a problem. Why is that a problem?
So we don't know what kind of particle it is. Mm. So we know that we can see through it. We have a pretty good guess that it's like surrounding us, like it's going through us right now. But we don't know what kind of particle it is. We don't know what its specific properties are. We don't know how massive each individual particle is, whether it has quantum mechanical spin or not, how to describe it mathematically. We don't have any of that information.
Hence, that's why it's a problem.
Yeah, that's why it's a problem, because we don't understand it.
Wow. Listen, as you can tell, I'm very intrigued with all of this. I have so many questions. I could probably keep you on for another 45 minutes, but I won't do that to you tonight. But I really appreciate you taking the time to talk to me and my listeners. This is really fascinating stuff. And I hope, Dr. Chanda, that this won't be the last time. And also, I would love to connect with some of your colleagues and get some other resources to get more information and more interviews to cover these subjects. That's just really fascinating to me, and as well, I'm sure, to my listeners as well.
Yeah, well, I suggest, since you had like good questions about Fermi Lab, Brian Nord will definitely say much more interesting things about what's happening there since he works there. So I would definitely recommend him.
Well, is there anything else that you would like to share with my listeners? Do you have any upcoming lectures or anything? I know that you're a professor at the University of New Hampshire. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Anything that you would like to share with my listeners out there?
Yeah. I mean, I guess I will do my editor the favor of mentioning that I'm working on a book right now called The Disordered Cosmos. So that's supposed to come out in March or April of next year. So that's pretty exciting. I mean, I guess it will be exciting when I finish it. But I also just kind of want to make a plug for people. You know, I grew up in the inner city where we had a lot of streetlights, and Los Angeles is like famous for like its light pollution. I really want to make a plug for people Now, if you have kids, if you can afford to and find the time to take them somewhere where they can see a dark night sky, I really think that this is one of the things that children who grow up in urban low-income communities are often denied. There's a kind of awe that you experience that just won't happen in the city. And so people who are thinking about programming for children and that kind of thing, I just really want to encourage people to go see the night sky without nightlights. It's an incredible experience. And it's our heritage. I think that often this is thought about something that, like I am not a hiker. I'm like, that's something that, like, my white friends really like to do. Some of my black friends really like to do. But I am, like, one of those people who's like, I'm happy in my air-conditioned apartment, that whole thing, right? But at the end of the day, the night sky doesn't belong to people of one racial group or one ethnicity or one socioeconomic class. And so I really want to encourage people, when and where possible, to go see a dark night sky.
That is awesome. Well, listen, Dr. Chanda, when your book comes out, please just know that you do have a platform here to talk about it, to promote it. And if you want to, you know, need a platform to get anything else that you would like to share that you're passionate about, just know that I'm just an email or a phone call away. My platform will always be open for you. I'm really excited for all the work that you've done, the doors that you are continuing to open for other people that look like you, and just be encouraged, and my hat is off to you. I'm very, really proud and honored that you took the time to talk to me today.
Well, thank you so much for having me, and thanks for the warm welcome and the invitation. I really appreciate it.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we got to take a quick break as we are talking to Dr. Chanda Prescod-Weinstein. Stay right there. We'll be back after this on Flow of Wisdom Radio.